And welcome to part two of our examination of seismic risk in the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta and how the proposed Delta Conveyance Project would help protect California's water supply in the event of a major earthquake. In part one, we heard from DWR senior engineer Lawrence Sanity about the potentially devastating result that earthquake-triggered levee failures would have due to saltwater inflow into the Delta, and the measures that are currently in place to manage such an event if it were to occur today. In this episode, we'll hear from two of California's leading seismology experts about the vulnerability of the Delta to a major seismic event, given what we know about the area's history and geology. With me today are Scott Brandenberg, professor of civil and environmental engineering at the University of California, Los Angeles, and Dr. Norm Abrahamson, adjunct professor in civil and environmental engineering at the University of California, Berkeley and UC Davis. They are both consultants to the Delta Conveyance Design and Construction Authority. Welcome to you both, and thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Pat.
All right, so Norm, you contributed to a landmark DWR report that was published in 2009, the Delta Risk Management Strategy, which states that, quote, the risk of levee failure in the Delta due to an earthquake will increase by 35% over the next 50 years and by 93% over the next 100 years. Can you help us understand those numbers a little bit? What factors come into play when making that type of prediction?
Thanks, Pat. There's two reasons why probabilities can change over time. The chance of the earthquakes can be changing, and the conditions in the Delta can be changing that makes it changes their capability to withstand the ground shaking. For example, in the Delta, as the water heights rise, there'll be a different capability of the Delta to withstand a strong earthquake. But I'm going to talk about the seismology part, as that's my area of expertise. So this is a plot of the faults in the Bay Area region that were studied during the DREAMS seismic risk evaluation. And with the Delta here on the right-hand side, the key faults have been the San Andreas Fault, the Hayward-Rogers Creek Fault, and then we have a whole lot of local, smaller local faults near the Delta region. In seismology, we know that the plates here, the Pacific Ocean plate is moving north with respect to North America at about 50 millimeters a year. That builds up. So at some point, we have to have an earthquake. If an earthquake hasn't happened in a while, then the chance this keeps moving, the Pacific Ocean keeps moving with respect to North America, and eventually we have to have an earthquake. So in seismology, we use models that capture this effect. Now, you will have heard previously in the Bay Area, there's a 67% chance of a large earthquake being magnitude 6.7 or larger in the next 30 years. But for the Delta, we're going to worry about larger earthquakes only. For example, closer to 7.5 to 8 earthquakes on the San Andreas Fault, or 7 earthquakes on the Hayward Fault, or smaller magnitude 6s to 7 earthquakes on the local faults. But the time dependence comes from these big major faults, the San Andreas and the Hayward. And on this plot shows you from the year how our probabilities of not a 6.7 or larger, but a 7.5 or larger earthquake on the San Andreas or magnitude 7 or larger on the Hayward fault has changed over time. So we had a big earthquake on the San Andreas fault in 1906. And now after that happens, it takes time for the stress to build up again along the fault. And then eventually we're going to release it in a big earthquake. So as we wait longer and longer, the chance of an earthquake happening in the next 30 years is increased. So at the times of the DMRS study, it was somewhere about a 3% chance of a big earthquake on the San Andreas Fault. Today, as we move forward, that number has moved up to something closer to 5%, and it keeps increasing. For the Hayward Fault, the last big earthquake was in 1868, and we're already well through the getting through the earthquake cycle, and it's why we call this fault being overdue.
Very interesting. So we know that it's a notoriously hard thing to predict when earthquakes will occur. But Norm, can you explain for us how seismologists can calculate the strength of the ground shaking from an earthquake?
Yes, Pat. So there's two main features that we're going to think about or when measuring the ground shaking. An earthquake magnitude tells us the total amount of energy that's being released on the fault. But what we care about is how strong of shaking makes it from the fault to our site. So that's going to be, we use models we'll call ground motion models that tell us how strong the shaking is depending on the magnitude of the earthquake, how far away you are, and your site conditions. So let me show you a plot that explains this. So on the right, left-hand side is a plot that has distance away from the fault on the x-axis and the peak acceleration on the y-axis. So this is the largest acceleration of the ground. And we measure this in the strength of gravity. So 0.5 would be half of the strength of gravity. And this is a horizontal shaking. And you can see these amplitudes of the shaking decrease rapidly as you move away from the fault. So a close-in earthquake will have much stronger shaking than being further away, even though it has the same magnitude. So this is just the energy is spreading out, much like if you had a light bulb and you stepped away from the light, it will get weaker and weaker as you get further from it. The ground motion is attenuating in that same sort of a fashion. But the other thing that's important for structures like the delta is how long the ground shakes. And so our second parameter we look at is the duration of the shaking. So we have this amplitude on the left, but then how long does it shake? And that duration depends on the magnitude of the earthquake. A bigger earthquake has a longer duration. So magnitude 6, 7, or 8, the duration goes up, but it also goes up as you get further away. So you get a low, as you go further away, the amplitude goes down, but then the length of shaking increases, the time that it shakes. And that's because of how waves propagate through the earth and scatter through different parts of the crust.
So that's a very important point then, the difference between the magnitude of an earthquake and the shaking that results, which depends on the composition of the materials above and around the epicenter. And Scott, this is where you engineers take up the story. So tell us about some of the studies that have been done to determine how delta levees would hold up or not during an earthquake.
Sure, Pat, I'd be happy to talk about that. So the delta has some pretty unique soil. It's organic soil, peat. It looks like garden potting soil, a little different from the types of soil that exist at most sites that we deal with for earthquake engineering. And there's really two aspects of it. One is that soft soils tend to alter earthquake waves. So the amount of shaking that happens at a particular site depends on how soft the soil is beneath it. And the softer soils alter that shaking more than stiffer soils. And so there have been studies to look at that site response problem. How strong is the shaking going to be at the surface for a given amount of shaking at the bottom of these soft soil layers? And the peat soils have been found to amplify ground shaking quite a bit. Then there's the question of how well are the levees going to perform? Or is there going to be a lot of deformation? Will they slump and settle and fail and overtop? Or will they hold up to this earthquake shaking and be fine and continue to hold back water? And there have also been studies on that. At UCLA, we've done a couple of studies. We conducted a field test on a model levee on Sherman Island in the Western Delta. And we deliberately made that levee really strong because we wanted to study the peat underneath it. And so we shook the levee and then monitored its settlement over time because disturbing the peat with earthquake waves can accelerate settlement of levees. We've also done studies on the centrifuge modeling facility at UC Davis, where we built levees out of modeling clay, and then we built levees out of sand. And the sand is similar to conditions that exist in the Delta. There are levees there that are composed of sand that's susceptible to liquefaction. And those levees in our centrifuge test did in fact liquefy and settle and water overtopped them. which I think is a pretty realistic model of conditions that exist at some delta sites.
But delta levees have not really been shaken strongly by an earthquake during their lifetime. Are there other levee systems around the world that have been seismically tested like that?
Yeah, Pat, that's a great question. Like you mentioned, the delta levees have never been shaken by strong earthquake, at least during their time of holding back water for agricultural and urban water users. So we have looked at other levee systems around the world. And in fact, there are quite a few levee systems that have been shaken by strong earthquakes. I spent quite a bit of time studying a couple in Japan in Niigata Prefecture, and they were shaken by earthquakes in 2004 and 2007. And our Japanese engineering colleagues do a pretty phenomenal job of inspecting their levees, reporting out on all of the cracks and displacement and settlement. And so we've been able to map out how those levees performed relative to the shaking intensity from the earthquakes that affected them. And we've derived what we call fragility functions. It's an expression of the probability of the levee settling more than a certain amount conditioned on the level of ground shaking. Now, those fragility functions are for the Japanese levee systems. And those levees are different from levees in the Delta for a couple of reasons. Most of the levees in Japan are not resting on peat soil, although we did study some in Hokkaido, the northern island in Japan, that do rest on peat. And those actually are more fragile than the ones that don't rest on peat. And then, you know, really importantly, the levees in Japan are flood control levees, which means that they don't have water up against them all the time. They only hold back water during a flood event, and they're high and dry most of the time, which means that there's less prospect for fill soils to liquefy, whereas delta levees have high water against them year round and are saturated through part of the levee all the time. So there's more susceptibility to liquefaction for those delta levees.
Great. So I want to go back just for a minute to the probability question again, because it's a favorite talking point for people who are skeptical about the need for the delta conveyance tunnel. So Norm, people sometimes point to the magnitude 6 earthquake in Napa in the 2014 earthquake and the lack of damage in the Delta as evidence for those Delta levees' ability to withstand a large earthquake. How would you respond to that?
Yes, Pat. So there's two aspects of the impact of the Napa earthquake on the levee system. And first, it's about 20 to 30 kilometers away from different parts of the Delta. So we're not getting a magnitude 6 close in. We're seeing that magnitude 6 after the energy has attenuated. The second part is all magnitude 6s are not the same. And it just happens that the ground motions that we got from the Napa earthquake were lower than a typical magnitude 6 would have been in the Delta region.
Very helpful. Thank you. So Scott, shortly after that 2014 Napa quake, you wrote in the LA Times that we had dodged a bullet and that the catastrophic scenario of years of salty water in the Delta might have occurred had the earthquake struck near or beneath the Delta. Why do you think we didn't see levee failure from that 2014 Napa earthquake?
Basically, I said that we dodged a bullet because that magnitude 6 event that happened in Napa could happen in the Delta, or a bigger magnitude earthquake could happen that could shake the levees more strongly. And Norm, I don't know if you have anything to add about that, or if you've said what you wanted to say about the Napa earthquake.
No, it's we have to keep in mind, again, all earthquakes are not the same. There's tremendous variability in how strong the shaking is from one earthquake to the next. That's why we model all these things with probability, because we can't tell you exactly what's going to happen. But that the shaking in the Delta at that time was not at all representative of what we'd see from a local magnitude 6 on any of the nearby faults. We would expect much stronger shaking to occur.
Got it. Okay, Scott, back to you. It's often suggested that rather than spending a lot of money on building the Delta conveyance tunnel, we should just reinforce all the vulnerable levees. Is this a realistic proposition? is it possible to design levees to withstand strong earthquakes?
It's possible to design them. It would maybe cost a lot of money because levee systems are very difficult because a levee system is a series system. So if we think about, you know, an island that's protected by the levees that go around the perimeter of the island, if any part of the levee settles too much and gets overtopped, it will fail. It'll erode away and fail. So, you know, an island that has, say, that has 20 kilometers of levee around it, you know, that would be 12 miles or something like that. The question is, how do we design these levees so that no spot around this entire length of levee fails? And that's a real challenge. You know, we tend to do our analyses in a two-dimensional cross-section, and we don't do a very good job in engineering of extending that along the length of an entire levee perimeter. So I always use the weakest link in the chain analogy, right? If you pull on a chain in tension, the weakest link is the one that will control the whole capacity of the chain. And levee systems are like that. So it's really difficult for us to know for sure that no bad spot is going to exist on all of these long levee systems that protect the islands in the Delta.
So as we heard in part one of this seismic risk discussion, the proposed Delta Conveyance Project would help to guarantee the state's water supply in the event of a influx of salt water into the Delta near the existing water pumps by providing conveyance intakes in the North Delta. But what about the safety of a tunnel in an earthquake? What is it about a tunnel that makes it better able to withstand an earthquake rather than a canal or pipes on the surface?
I guess there are two aspects. I think Norm maybe can talk about the distribution of ground motion with depth, but I'll talk about the surficial soils. You know, we have this peat soil up near the surface. There's liquefiable materials within the levee itself and right beneath the levee in some cases. And all of those problematic soils are really the driver of levee risk. So by putting the tunnel beneath all of those soft sediments, we take away that part, that geotechnical hazard that is related to the potential for failure of these shallow sediments. And maybe Norm, do you want to talk about the ground shaking?
Yeah, Scott. So some of the advantages of a tunnel is you're at depth, and the ground motion at depth is much less than the ground motion at the surface. The other key factor is that tunnels are, for seismic design, are mainly sensitive to something called the peak velocity. They are much less sensitive to the duration of shaking. So that makes it less impacted by these long duration big earthquakes in the Bay Area that are more likely. And I think fundamentally, you can just design a tunnel with much more confidence that it will perform as planned. As Scott mentioned, working on the surface is the uncertainties are just so large that we can't be confident that any design that we have come up with on the surface will actually give us the good performance that we're after. But working down at depth in the tunnels, we have much less uncertainty and can come up, we'll be much more confident that we've got a design that will last for a long time.
Great. Well, Norm and Scott, I'd like to thank you both so much for joining us today and giving us some very useful information about seismic risk in the Delta.
All right. Thanks, Pat.
Thank you, Pat.
To all our viewers, we hope that you will join us for our next deep dive video. Visit the Delta Conveyance playlist on YouTube to see more episodes of the Delta Conveyance Deep Dive video series. And we have a long list of future topics, so please stay tuned. Thanks for watching.